ఇంటర్మీడియట్ విద్యా రంగంలో అగ్రగామి మన ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ ఇన్స్టిట్యూషన్ ఐఐటి జేఈఈ అయినా నీట్ అయినా తిరుగులేని విద్యా సంస్థ ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్
రైట్ నౌ లెట్ us కంటిన్యూ విత్ ద థర్డ్ కేటగిరీ సెకండ్ కేటగిరీ అండర్ ఫిజియోలాజికల్ రూట్స్ సో ఇన్ ఫిజియోలాజికల్ రూట్స్ వాట్స్ ద ఫస్ట్ కేటగిరీ వి స్టడీడ్ పారాసైట్స్ Okay, so what is the first category we write? So in physiological roots, the first category is parasites. And what is the second category we take? Epiphytes. First category is parasites. And what is the second category? Epiphytes. And what is the third category we have to discuss? Photosynthetic roots. Okay, so I repeat again. First category under physiological roots. Physiological roots means they talk about some physiological processes. The roots which are involved in doing some physiological processes. What are they? Parasites. Second category is epiphytes. Third category is photosynthetic roots. We already studied parasites. Now let us talk about what epiphytes. And third category is what photosynthetic roots. Let us talk about epiphytes. What are these epiphytes? So here these epiphytes are nothing but which grow on the branches of other plants which grow on the branches of other plants so these are called epiphytes what are these epiphytes are they are aerial and they grow on branches of other trees they grow on branches of other trees what exactly meaning of this for example if you look at if this is a tree so here it has branches on the branches of other trees whenever rainfall occurs these small plants will grow okay so the smaller plants the very small plants which are aerial which grow on branches of other trees then they are called which grow on branches of other trees they are called as what these are called epiphytes these are called epiphytes so these are called epiphytes epi means on the surface phytes means plants epi means on the surface phytes means plants plants grow on the surface of other plants on the surface epi surface phytes means plants on the surface of other plants so here if you take these are nothing but it contains two types of roots epiphytes generally they contain so what are epiphytes epiphytes contain two types of roots what are the two types of root here it contain so these short ones are called and long ones are called short ones are called as here they are called as clinging roots and long ones are called they are called velamen roots okay they contain two types of roots I repeat the plants which grow on the branches this is a branch I cut the branch from here to here so this is a branch I cut it and I took it out this is how it looks So what you find, this is a plant called epiphyte which grow on the branches of other plant. If you look at carefully, it contain smaller roots and longer roots. Smaller roots, what you find, they are called clinging roots, and the longer roots, what you find them, they are called as what? Velamen roots. Now clinging roots, they are short and branched. They are called short and branched. They are short and they are branched. They are short and they are branched. They contain branches. As they are short and branched, they are called clinging roots. What do they do? What is the function of them? They provide mechanical support. They provide mechanical support. Okay, it's okay, no problem. So here if you look at, they are short and branched and they provide mechanical support. They are called as clinging roots. Clinging roots are called what? The clinging roots are defined it as what? Short, and they are branched and they provide mechanical support. They are called as what? Clinging roots. Next is what? Velamen roots. What are velamen roots? Velamens are long and unbranched. They are long and moreover they are unbranched. Meaning what here? They are very long but here no branches. They are very long and no branches. Now these are called what? Velamen roots. Long and there are no branches. Long, unbranched. What is the function of this? It contains, velamen roots contain, I am talking about velamen roots. Velamen roots contain a dead hygroscopic tissue. A dead hygroscopic tissue. A dead hygroscopic tissue is called velamen. It's called velamen. Okay, the velamen roots contain a dead hygroscopic tissue. It's called what? Velamen. What is the meaning of dead? It's a dead tissue. It is made up of a special tissue called as what? Velamen tissue. What is it contain? A dead tissue means it contain dead cells. It contain all dead cells. These dead cells are called as what? Velamen tissue. The dead cells what we find here, it's called velamen tissue. Hygroscopic meaning what? Drastically it absorbs moisture content. Whenever moisture content or some wet or some water is available, immediately takes water. Sharp absorption, it's called hygroscopic. Drastic absorption of water. Dead hygroscopic tissue, it's called velamen. What is the function of velamen? Velamen absorb. Velamen absorb moisture from atmosphere. Moisture from atmosphere. What's the meaning of this? Velamen roots are long and unbranched and contain what? Dead hygroscopic tissue. What the dead hygroscopic tissue is called? Velamen. What velamen will do? Velamen absorb moisture from atmosphere. Why? See here, whenever rainfall is there, little water is available on the surface of the branch. But this little water is not sufficient to make the plant to survive. So what it will do? It develops a special tissue, special roots called velamen roots. Very, very important. So I'll give 3 star marks means it's very, very important. A special dead cells called velamen tissue, they absorb moisture content from the atmosphere. So this is about what we call epiphytes. Take down examples for epiphytes. Vanda. Vanda is an epiphyte. And even you can take example orchids. Orchid is a example. Another example is nothing but teniophyllum. Tenofilm is also very, very important. We'll come back to this tenofilm. Okay, tenofilm is also very, very important. We'll come back to this tenofilm. I repeat again. Right, we'll discuss again. Tenofilm, I repeat, this is totally one plant name. So this is vander, orchids, and these all are examples. What is the first example? Vander. What is the second example? Orchids. And what is the third example? Tenofilm. Vander, orchids, tenofilm are very, very, very important. Okay, these three are examples of epiphytes. Now, let us go with the third category. What is the third category we have? Photosynthetic roots. What is the third category? Photosynthetic roots, also called as assimilatory roots. Photosynthetic roots are also called as assimilatory roots. What are these assimilatory roots here? Assimilator means they accumulate food, and they undergo what is called photosynthesis. That's why they are called photosynthetic roots, are also called as assimilatory roots. Now let us talk about this. Now in this case, the roots are aerial. So we talk from here. The roots are, they are aerial, means they grow outside, contain chlorophyll, they are chlorophyllous. Chlorophyllous means they contain chlorophyll. They are green in color, green in color, and undergo photosynthesis. Photosynthesis means they prepare food. Are called photosynthetic roots or assimilatory roots. What's the meaning of this? So if you take, we are talking about photosynthetic roots here. Maybe if you take, this is a plant, maybe you take, this is a plant, you take. So here, let us go further, this is a plant. On this, roots are aerial. They are aerial. Okay, so these are called as photosynthetic roots. Why they are called photosynthetic roots? Here in this plant, the roots are aerial. Generally roots are in the underground, but in this plant roots are aerial. They are above to the soil. Soil is here. They are above to the soil. So what's happening in this case here? The roots are aerial, they grow above the soil, and they are chlorophyllous. Chlorophyllous means what? They are green in color. They are green in color. They contain chlorophyll. They are green in color. Green in color means generally roots are brown in color. In most of the plants, roots are generally brown in color. Roots are lack of chlorophyll, means chlorophyll is absent in roots. Exceptionally means very, very important. That means here roots are green in color. In rest all cases, roots are brown in color. Especially roots are green in color as they undergo photosynthesis. You know very well, photosynthesis is a process of making food here. So as they green in color, they prepare their own food, meaning they undergo photosynthesis. That's why they are called photosynthetic roots. They store food, they accumulate food, they assimilate food. That's why they are also called assimilatory roots. Okay, examples are very important. Let us talk about examples. Now in this case, we can talk about example Tenospora. Example purpose, you remember T cube. What is the example? That is T cube. Remember T cube, the three plants which starts with T. Okay, T cube, this is nothing but example. So what is example? First plant is Tenospora. It's a woody twiner. It's a woody twiner. Tenospora, it's a woody twiner. Woody twiner meaning what? It surrounds on one other plant. This is a host plant. If you take, This is a woody twiner. It twines. This is very woody, very strong. It turns like this. Like this. This is a woody twiner. Okay, very woody twiner. Who is that? Tenospora. Remember this. Similarly, next example, very very important example, Taeniophyllum. Taeniophyllum, here in this case, it is also very important because it is an epiphyte. Okay, here it is an epiphyte, meaning this is a Taeniophyllum. Taeniophyllum grows where? On the branches of other trees. Okay, Taeniophyllum is an epiphyte. It's an epiphyte which grow on the branches of other trees. But instead of this roots, what it also contain? Along with them, it also contain photosynthetic roots. So it shows two root modifications. Very, very, very important. That's why I kept 3 star marks. Taeniophyllum is, I repeat, Taeniophyllum is very very important because Taeniophyllum is an epiphyte. It grow on the branches of other plants and also it shows photosynthetic roots. What it shows? Photosynthetic roots. It is an epiphyte and also it shows photosynthetic roots. Very 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 important. Other one is also starts with capital T, that is Trapa. Trapa. Trapa is a submerged hydrophyte. It's an submerged hydrophyte. Submerged hydrophyte means it's floating. It's in the water. Hydrophyte means the plant is in the water. So probably after understanding these 3 examples, then you can imagine in your young mind what might be the questions appear on the paper on this concept. Suppose if the question is a woody twiner which contain photosynthetic roots or assimilatory roots means, then you have to choose the option Taeniospora. Suppose if the question is the photosynthetic roots and it is an epiphyte, then the example you have to choose Taeniophyllum. And if the question is photosynthetic root and it is a the plant which shows photosynthetic roots and it is a submerged hydrophyte with the floating leaves, then you have to choose the example Trapa. Remember, all 3 starts with T. That's why this is example we have to remember, T cube. Photosynthetic roots or assimilated roots, you can remember the example as T cube. Hopefully you got this both categories. I repeat again, physiological roots, we have discussed about root parasites. Parasites are root parasites, stem parasites, incomplete root parasites, complete root parasites, stem parasites, incomplete stem parasites and complete stem parasites. That's over, right? Continuation of the second category is epiphytes. What are they? They are aerial and they grow on the branches of other trees. So when rainfall is there, they grow, they are called epiphytes. And these epiphytes contain 2 types of roots. What are they? Some are short and branched. Short and branched and provide mechanical support, they are called clinging roots. Some are long and unbranched, they are called velamen roots. These velamen roots contain dead hygroscopic tissue called velamen tissue. These velamen tissue absorb moisture from the atmosphere, right? What are the examples? Vanda, orchids, Taeniophyllum. I repeat, Vanda, orchids, Taeniophyllum. Coming to the third category, photosynthetic roots or assimilatory roots. In this case, roots are aerial. They contain chlorophyll. So they are chlorophyllous. They are green in color. And as they undergo photosynthesis, that means they prepare their own food material. So this is a photosynthetic roots containing plant. The roots are aerial. So they are called photosynthetic roots. They are green in color. And where do you find them? So first example is Taeniospora. Taeniospora, it's a woody twiner. It's very woody twiner. Taeniophyllum, it shows 2 types of root modifications. What are they? Epiphytes and photosynthetic roots. Very, very important. And third one, Trapa. Trapa is a submerged hydrophyte. So these all are nothing but what we call root modifications. I hope we clear with this. Root modifications are divided into 2. Tap root modifications, adventitious root modifications. tap root has some 3 or 4 types. Then adventitious roots also have the 3 categories, and along with the examples we discussed all 3 categories. What are they? Storage roots, mechanical roots, and the third one is nothing but what? Physiological roots. So this all will come under root modifications. Examples are very, very important. Right. Now, so far we discussed about root modifications. So let us continue about stem. Now, if you take the stem part, earlier also we discussed. Now, if you look at the stem part, what are the things you have to study to remember here? Okay. So if you look at the stem part, let's come back to the once again the part. The place where it go, it's called apical bud, or itself is called terminal bud. Apical bud or itself is called terminal bud. And the place where the branch arises or the leaf arises, okay, that is called as what? Axillary bud, or itself is called as lateral bud. Okay, so what it called? Axillary bud, or itself is called as what? Lateral bud. Right, and the place where leaf arises, it's called as the node. It's called as what? Node, right? So here, this is nothing but shoot system. If you take the shoot system, the growth part, if you talk about the growth here, if you see, what are the things we will determine? Growth occurs from the apical bud. It keeps growing. It keeps growing. So what you call the growth here? We call this is as phototrophism. It's called as what? Phototrophism. Photo means it's growing towards the sunlight. It's growing towards the sunlight. Photo, towards light. Trophism, movement or growth. It's called phototrophism. Growth of the shoot system is, growth of the shoot system is phototrophism. Okay. So if you look at the stem part here, stem is the one, you know, it provides functions. If you talk about the stem, I am writing stem functions. Stem functions here. Generally, the function is conduction of food and water. Okay. Generally, the stem functions are conduction of food and water. Right, apart from this, it provides mechanical support. It provides a mechanical support. It transfers food and water to all the parts of the plant. And second most important one is it provides mechanical support. In some cases, it undergo perennation. It undergo perennation. Perennation means penetrating, perennation, to tide over unfavorable condition. It undergo perennation to tide over unfavorable condition, and it stores food. Okay, so come back again to the functions. You can understand this connection of food and water means transfers food and water to all the parts of the plant. Second one, it provides mechanical support. Undergo perennation. Perennation to tide over unfavorable conditions. What's the meaning of this? Undergo perennation means in some cases where stem penetrates, this is the stem part, this is soil, okay, Sometimes stem penetrates, means it penetrates, it grow into the deeper layers of the soil. Who? The stem grows into the deeper layers of the soil. That is called perennation. Perennation ante chochukoni povadam. Perennating, it's going deeper and deep. Who? Stem. Okay, it undergo perennation to tide over unfavorable environmental conditions. Whenever conditions, environmental condition is not favorable, then stem will go inside. What it will do? It stores food. It stores food. It stores food. Okay, so that happens in some cases. Some cases it also involved in storage of food. So apart from this, it also undergo photosynthesis. Photosynthesis means stem is a green color part which contains chlorophyll. Obviously, it has the stamina to prepare its own food by the process called photosynthesis. So this will come under functions of stem. Then directly let us talk about now stem modifications. Let us talk about stem modifications. Let us talk about stem modifications. So what do we do in stem modifications generally? First of all, what is a modification? We already have discussed. What is stem modification? What is a modification? We already have discussed. What we discussed? A permanent change. Same definition will come. What we discussed for root modification, same definition will come. But in place of root, we say it's stem. In place of root, we write stem. So what is stem modification here? A permanent change in. A permanent change in shape of stem to perform special functions, to perform a special functions like absorb storage, right, along with that even photosynthesis and even to provide protection and climbing. Climbing means what? Mechanical support. Anyway, that is enough. Okay, the definition is common for all. What is the definition? It's common for all. A permanent change in the shape of the stem to perform a special functions like. So it will undergo some permanent change. Where, who will undergo? Stem will undergo. Same definition we discussed for root. A permanent change, some permanent change will it undergo to perform special functions. What special functions it will do? Storage, photosynthesis, protection and climbing. So then they are called as what? Stem modifications. Now let me give you overall picture of the total complete block diagram for stem modifications. Then we can discuss one by one, because if I start writing one by one, you will get confusion. So at a time I will write complete block diagram for stem modifications, then you can start, we can start discussing one after the other. I hope you got it now. I repeat again, stem is nothing but stem contains tip. It contains what is called apical or terminal bud. Laterally, what it contains is called axillary or lateral bud. You know, this gives rise to leaves and branches. Apical bud is the one where cells divide and growth takes place. The place from where leaf arises, it's called as the node, right? And here shoot system is there. And here you can see the shoot system. Sometimes it will go inside. That means that will come under function. Stem undergo perennation to tide over unfavorable conditions, simply to protect it from environment. Sometimes stem penetrates inside and stores food, right? Apart from this function, stem also provide mechanical support and it is involved in photosynthesis, also involved in connection of food and water. So what is stem modification? a permanent change in the shape of the stem to perform a special functions like storage, photosynthesis, protection and climbing. So this is nothing but what? Definition for modification of stem, right? Now we'll discuss the block diagram. What you can take? You can take horizontal page, right? There are three categories of stem modifications. Take the horizontal page and write all three categories. Right. So here if you look at stem modifications are classified into three categories. Classified into three types. In generally if you look at stem modifications are classified into how many types? Three types. What are they? The first category is called underground stem modifications and second one it's called as aerial stem modifications and the third category is called as subaerial stem modifications. Subaerial stem modifications. All three categories. What are the three categories we have to remember? Stem modifications where stem may penetrate into the deeper layers of the soil. It can grow into underground. So, it undergoes some modifications called underground stem modifications. Similarly, in some plants where stem is aerial no doubt, but still it will undergo some modifications come under aerial stem modifications. And third category is subaerial stem modifications, partly aerial. Who stem is partly aerial, partly underground, and it shows some modifications. Subaerial stem modifications, right. Now, let us talk about the first category, underground stem modifications. I'll take the horizontal page, make it into three columns. I'll give you the block diagram. Make sure that you copy down and we'll discuss one after the other. Now, underground stem modifications are further divided into here four groups. They are further divided into four groups. The first one is called rhizome. The first category is called rhizome. And second category is called conk. Third category is called stem tuber. And the fourth category is called bulb. Okay, underground stem modifications are further divided into four categories. What are they? Four groups. Rhizome. Listen carefully pronunciation. Rhizome. Second one is comb. Third one is stem tuber. Fourth one is bulb. Now coming to aerial stem modifications are also further divided into many categories. The first one is tendrils. tendrils. Second one is we can take, apart from the tendrils, you can take aerial ones, climbers, right? Apart from tendrils, tendrils itself modify and form different structures. Structurally, they slightly differ. What are they? They may be thorns, and next they may be hooks, and they may be phylloclade. Phylloclade, and then cladophyll. Here you only write down phylloclade, or you may find cladophyll. And the next one is bulbil. Okay, all together let us take 5 types. Which are divided into 5 types? Aerial stem modifications further divide into 5 types. Which are those 5 types? Tendrils we call, thorns we call, hooks we call, then phylloclade or cladophyll, and the 5th category is called as what? Bulbil. Tendrils, pronunciation listen carefully, thorns, hooks, phylloclade or cladophyll, and then bulbil. Coming to subaerial, subaerial means what? Partly aerial, partly underground. So here they are divided into 4 types. So we call them as, first category we call them as runners, then second category we call them as stolons, and then suckers, and lastly offset. Okay, partly aerial, partly underground. What's that? They are runners. Runners, they keep growing. Second one, stolons. Listen carefully pronunciation. Runners, stolons, suckers, and offset. So all these 4 categories will come under subaerial stem modifications. So we can discuss one after the other. So before I start over these categories here, so it's very clearly you have to understand the characteristics of the stem. Then definition for stem modifications. In stem modifications altogether, these are the important 3 categories to be discussed. Okay, so you have to remember total block diagram in your mind. Then only you will understand. If I start discussing one after the other, if I am in the bulb, you will understand, oh, this is nothing but underground stem modifications. When I'm keep flowing and running with the hooks or thorns, you have to remember they fall in what you call aerial stem modifications. When I come to the end, stolons and suckers are offset, you have to remember subaerial stem modifications. What you have to take the horizontal page, write all 3 categories individually, we have to discuss them. I repeat, underground stem includes rhizome, comb, stem tuber, bulb. Aerial stem modifications include tendrils, thorns, hooks, phylloclade, cladophyll, bulbil. Subaerial modifications include runners, stolons, suckers, and offsets. Now here, as we discuss the stem modifications, let me give you table 1 and table 2 continuation. What is the table 1? Name of the scientist and discovery. Right. So let us continue with the discovery part. Let us talk about the scientist. I think altogether 7 or 8 we discussed. Let us take Anton von Leeuwenhoek. Who is the scientist? Anton von Leeuwenhoek. He is the first first living cell. What did he describe? A first living cell. Who is the first non-living cell? Robert Hooke. Who discovered first living cell? Anton von Leeuwenhoek. Not only this, he studied first time he studied invisible organisms called first time studied about a microorganisms. So I think earlier I told you which microorganisms he studied, bacteria, and also studied about fungi. Better you take down human RBC cell. Okay, so better you take down clearly. If you take which are the organisms which you studied is nothing but even what you call algae. But first living cell what you identified is bacteria, protozoa, and human RBC. Okay, what are the things he studied? Anton von Leeuwenhoek is the first person who studied and discovered first living cell. Which are the first living cell he studied? Today we know they are called protozoa, what he studied, and once upon a time what we studied, today we named it as bacteria, and even he took human RBC and observed. So these all are nothing but first living cells what he observed. In that, some of them are microorganisms. So he is the first person who identified microorganisms. I think I told you for the last class, invisible microorganisms discovered by Anton von Leeuwenhoek. Such a great effort of the scientist in making the world to prove yes, invisible microorganisms exist. Which microorganisms he studied? Bacteria, algae, fungi. But people did not believe. So what did he invented? He invented, constructed for the first light microscope. First light microscope. Right. To make the world to prove that first microorganisms exist, he is the one who invented, constructed first light microscope. He is the one first time who identified microorganisms. So he is called father of microbiology. He is called father of microbiology. There is a separate branch of science which is called father of microbiology. So this is about Anton von Leeuwenhoek. There is other scientist, Ehrenberg. Who is the other scientist? Ehrenberg. Ehrenberg is the one who first coined the term. Who first coined the term? What is the term? Bacteria. Who first coined the term? That is bacteria. Ehrenberg is a scientist who first time coined the term called as bacteria. So remember about these two scientists. This is nothing but table number 1. Right. Now let us go with table number 2. So what is there in table number 2? We have to remember scientific name and common name. Scientific name and common name. Right. So let me give you 2. Faciolus mungo. It's commonly called as a black. Okay, this is commonly called background. Other one is Faciolus aureus, commonly called green gram. So very easy to remember scientific name and the common name. So what is that you have to? Okay, so what is that? Faciolus mungo. I repeat again, pronunciation listen carefully. Faciolus mungo is the scientific name for black gram. Black gram is a common name. Faciolus aureus is a scientific name for green gram. So here the two names I repeat. Table number 2, we already have written some few scientific names. Continue with that. What is the next one? Genus name is same, species is different. If you take Faciolus mungo, black gram. Faciolus aureus, green gram.